A new day of relentless sunshine and torrid heat is dawning over the Venezuelan plains. Waterfowl, spoonbills, scarlet ibis, black ibis are concentrating in the last remaining waters on the cracked and barren plain. Elegant birds add a touch of color to a world that is turning yellow and ochre. Capybaras suffer most in drought. Huge rodents weighing 50 kilos that can only thermoregulate in water are looking for the last remnants of friscor. Only in the distant gallery forest that borders the great Apure River or the Portuguese or Sinaruco, life is as lively and vibrant as it has been since prehistoric times. At dawn, the howler monkeys greet the sun and tell everyone that the tiger, the king of the jungle, is going to start hunting. The jaguar, which is the most powerful of the South American big cats, is observed throughout the arboreal world. The spider monkey looks at him suspiciously and warns his fellow monkeys. Seeks a more secure position in the thinner branches of a tree, because the tiger has not hunted that night. He's looking for new prey, and all in the jungle know it. When the tiger walks in hiding, when Tyra sees him from her tree in the clearing, jungle people, forest animals, and gallery know that death is near. The pair of young cobatrosses also discover the tiger in time. The tiger is in no hurry. Will find its prey. The peccary, one of the most resistant and aggressive animals against predators, is smelling the stench of the beast. The huge tapir senses that danger is approaching, as does a deer. The tiger advances slowly. Its presumed prey flee, break through the bush, and emerge from their nests. But you will find a distracted, easy, inexperienced prey. A simple leap with lightning speed, a bite to the back of the neck, and the fawn is dead. The tiger, like all predators, chooses young or easy prey if it can. The South American jaguar, like all big cats, contributes to natural selection, killing unexpected sick or injured prey. To eat transports the piece to the deepest part of the thicket. In any place where it is safe, of monkeys that would start screaming if they caught you eating, of the hens that would come to participate in the feast after I finished with their meat, and from any intruder who might disturb their quiet banquet. The tiger is the king of the South American jungle, and all animals know it, to the painted toucan. Thank you. Even the lazy tridactyl that climbs up its branch like an acrobat to get further away from the danger that for this day has already passed. The tiger will rest. The tiger will not kill again until it gets hungry. And surely the tiger will again kill an easy prey. Meanwhile, late in the morning, far away in the torrid savanna, when the temperature reaches 40 degrees Celsius, the scissors bill fishes for small minnows in the turbulent waters. And the Gabon pionillo, which is a gigantic South American stork, scorns the toads dead from heat and dehydration. When the waters are diminishing, when the streams and lagoons are transformed into putrid and residual ponds, the jacanas search for food along the shores and are a feast for the giant otters, or water dogs, as they are called in Venezuela. They come from distant rivers and fish quietly in this turbulent world where fish and Mayan oxens are easy prey. They fish by the touch of their huge vibrissae, since nothing can be seen in the murky water. All predators take advantage of the drought in the plains, embraced by the scourge of the sun. The tamandua, or honey bear, as it is called by the llaneros, returns to finish eating the termites in the termite mound he has found at dawn. Its long, slimy, and very fast-moving tongue allows it to absorb small prey. But to quench his thirst, he has to go to the distant and putrid pond. The great waters are over in the Llano. In the Llano, which is a flooded world during the rainy months. The drought regime is comparable to that of any distant African desert. Animals must drink where they can and how they can. The heat is torrid. The breeze has stopped. And the armored armadillo searches for water in the cracked plain, where tomorrow there will no longer be a single drop of freshness. Meanwhile, the salvage team of man and earth advances across the dusty plain. Let's start Operation Anaconda. But certainly, before capturing the giant reptiles, we prepared to catch tortoises. As we move forward, any small mound of mud catches our attention, because underneath, a monster can be hidden. An alligator over 3 meters long, its jaws closing around our legs, would likely rip apart a nest. It is required to evacuate to all these fearsome and armored animals before continuing the capture of the Galapagos. The aggressiveness of alligators is extraordinary. To the great specimens. The llaneros call them babos because they are generally male. After we are done with the hazards, we are pushing the Galapagos, small freshwater turtles, into a quagmire, where the Pionese llaneros collaborate with us to put them in sacks and then transport them to the salvage truck. Certainly, if this operation were enough, thousands and thousands of freshwater turtles, dozens of anacondas, and large caimans would have died from dehydration. because in the first months of the drought, the ponds are already completely empty. And these animals can withstand a season in the wet mud, but they cannot withstand 6 months in the absolutely dehydrated soil. And with the nearest waters dozens of kilometers away. As a simple precaution, the plainsmen are evicting the dangerous animals that are hidden in the mud. Giant anacondas, 4-meter-long caimans. Creatures that could kill a man within minutes. We give instructions to the brave laborers to simply stroke these prized animals with the tips of their sticks. But they certainly need to be convinced to go elsewhere. We have to somehow tell them that we are going to work there to catch turtles and that we would not like to have a hand ripped off. Ceremoniously, the old alligators are retreating, while the anacondas are reluctant to leave their shelters, from where these armored saurians miraculously appear. That could cause, as we say, serious injuries to any of the men who collaborate with us. Disciplined, the team of llaneros with mud up to their knees, treading a land where any danger can be hidden, are advancing the freshwater turtles, hundreds and thousands of turtles. They are transported to the center of the lagoon and then to the dry shore to be taken to the vehicle where they will be transported to the distant free waters. All of these tortoises would die hopelessly from dehydration. They could endure a short season in the wet mud, but not in the absolutely parched and cracked earth that this lagoon will become in a couple of weeks. The terrible drought is causing water levels to drop in lakes and lagoons in the plains, where nothing like this has been known for 20 years. Amphibious animals were mainly in those waters. For this reason, hundreds of tortoises, caimans, and dozens of anacondas can be seen gathered together. Animals that are not seen in such abundance anywhere in the world. We are witnessing an overwhelming spectacle. We are contemplating and acting in a faunal concentration that surely has not been known since prehistoric times. And it is that the animals have gathered in the last wet and cool areas. There they would have waited patiently for death. First lethargy, and then dehydration. It is painful to work in temperatures of over 40 degrees on the parched plain. The patient, the solicitous, the brave plainsman give a very clear idea of their dedication to this exhausting work, whose vision is to save the lives of animals that undoubtedly had never meant much to the rural man. The truck will be filled throughout the day. These remote, primitive, and almost prehistoric beings are living an adventure very typical of our century. Adventure of the work of some men to save their lives, freeing them from an inevitable fate imposed by nature. But we wanted to avoid them. More than 5,000 freshwater turtles are released into the open waters. In a huge pipe in communication with the great rivers, where total drought can never reach. But with Operation Galapagos over, let's start Operation Anaconda. This is graver. We will be confronted with reptiles over 5 meters long, which can kill a man under their constrictor rings. They can cause serious wounds with their strong mouth, armed with numerous conical teeth that pierce deeply into the skin. It is necessary to use a very precise technique to avoid any damage when working with anacondas. It's critical to hold the reptile by the tail, the center of the body, and the neck at the same time. To grab him by the neck, one must be very fast. This prevents the snake from turning its head and biting you on one hand. Undoubtedly, the bite would not be fatal because these giant snakes lack venom. But it could cause very serious injuries by the simple traumatic action of its conical teeth. We have been able to experience the strength of these reptiles weighing close to 100 kilos, and it is truly shocking. Three or four men are absolutely essential to dominate them. These animals are in full vigor with an ambient temperature of 40 degrees. They are animals that have stored up energy and reserves to lethargize under the parched earth. The body of the anacondas, extraordinarily slippery due to the mud, makes it very difficult to hold them tightly. We slowly introduce them into sacks, and one by one, always trying to quickly grab the neck, so as not to find ourselves with a mouth of steel teeth. We are taking the anacondas out of their world, the viscous mud where it is very difficult to move. But if we did not cause these giant reptiles, one of the few left in the world, the trouble of pulling them out of the slimy mud, they would be dead in 2 or 3 months. Because anacondas can only move easily in areas where there are aquatic plants that retain moisture. Here, in these sandy lagoons, far from any permanent water center, dehydration would soon wipe out their reserves. Actually devoured by predators and even by omegas, the giant snakes would end their days. It is not easy to put a 7-meter snake in a sack, but somehow the giant reptiles have to be transported to the distant free waters. When the anaconda cannot be grabbed by the neck in the first moments of the fight, is when it is really dangerous because it can bite. Wait for the right moment to grab the animal by the neck. Actually, after capturing a few great trades, we had perhaps become overconfident, but only when we had the snake in our hands. We were aware of their cyclopean forces. We realized that a man in that environment could never take on one of these giants of the murky waters alone. A full day of wrestling with anacondas to rescue them is exhausting, especially when working a few meters away from alligators whose jaws are always ready to close on the first thing they find nearby. In our unusual operation of anaconda rescuers, we have the invaluable collaboration of Alvaro Maldonado, the owner of the Hato del Frio, by Professor Castroviejo, a renowned Spanish naturalist, and two young and brave laneros who were certainly not used to this type of work. But they gave themselves to them with as much technique as joy. After finishing with the anacondas, we decided to capture the old alligator as well, for fear that, far from the free waters, he would come to die when the odazal was transformed into a cracked rock, truly inhospitable even for a tough alligator. It was the first alligator we had captured on the plains, and we were certainly not aware of its fearsome reactions. Professor Castroviejo grabs it by the tail until the animal soon convinces us that it is necessary to walk with all kinds of precautions. Start by closing its mouth to avoid being bitten by its sharp teeth. And always keep a safe distance from the deadly clamp of its jaws to be able to at least finish the rescue operation with peace of mind. On dry ground, more comfortable and safer for our feet, we can already put the muzzle to the side. With the mouth tightly closed and the tail restrained, we have nothing to fear. And indeed, we commented with irony on our work to save the life of the old caiman, who surely must have known many droughts. As the plains suffer now, but we are almost convinced that they would never have put him in an off-road vehicle to take him to open waters. And so that it may continue to be one of the oldest and most impressive witnesses of the life of the Llanera for many years to come. With some of the anacondas, you will make your way to the large lagoon where aquatic plants abound, where the complete drought will never come, and where these amphibious reptiles will be able to wait quietly until the distant and great rains. Before proceeding to the release of these specimens of enormous scientific value, we proceed to measure them and take all the scientific data of interest to the expedition. And in which, with great technique and also with great passion, Professor Castroviejo leads the techniques. We transport anacondas in pairs using old fuel cans, which seem to us to be the only appropriate containers to protect themselves from the teeth of the aquatic giants. Ceremoniously, as if it were all part of something long awaited and familiar in their lives, giant snakes dive under aquatic plants. And we are all filled with great joy. We are running an incredible operation, saving the lives of animals that have always been feared by all, of animals that were considered to be cursed. But today, science knows that they are useful, that they are scarce, and which must be preserved if our planet is to continue to be inhabited by its creatures as it has always been. Mr. Caiman needs to be reminded that he has already arrived in a new paradise. Who may have territorial problems with the owner of this beautiful lagoon? But it will surely save your life without the need to bury yourself in the mud. Another afternoon falls on the scorched plain. The scourge of the sun has ended for the day. But tomorrow there will be hundreds and thousands of creatures who will no longer wait for certain death. We have modestly put our small grain of sand so that life in the Venezuelan plains continues to be more bearable for the great fauna of these territories.